Module 2, Chapter 1.6, Applications of Linear Functions, or Word Problems. A couple of steps for solving application problems. Step 1, read the problem and make sure you understand it. Assign a variable to what you're being asked to find, and if necessary, write other quantities in terms of this variable. Step 2. Write an equation that relates the quantities described in the problem. You may need to sketch a diagram and refer to known formulas. Step 3. Solve the equation and determine the solution. And step 4. Look back and check your solution. Not only do you check it by plugging it into your formula, but you also look back and ask yourself, could this be real? For instance, if you get a bike that travels at 110 miles per hour, you've probably missed it somewhere. Example number 1 is a mixture of concentrations problem. How much pure alcohol should be added to 20 liters of 40% alcohol to increase the concentration to 50% alcohol? Do you understand what they're asking you? You've got 40% alcohol and you have pure alcohol, and you need to know how much of the pure should you add to the 40 to get 50% alcohol. The easiest way I can tell you to do these is think of these in terms of mixture buckets. You've got a 40% mixture bucket, which we're going to label as 0.40. You've got a 100% mixture bucket, which we're going to label as 1.0, and you want to mix those until you get a 50% mixture bucket, which we are going to label as 0.50. Then we're going to determine how much goes in each bucket. Well, it tells us 20 liters of the 40% solution, and it asks us how much pure alcohol do we add to go into the, or how much alcohol of the pure alcohol do we add? Now think about this. If you add 20 liters of this to X liters of this, then your solution is going to have 20 plus X liters in it. So what we're going to do now is go through 40% of 20 liters. We're going to say 0.40 times 20. 100% of X, we're going to call that 1.00 times X. And 50% of what's left is we're going to call that 0.50 times 20 plus X. Now, working through that, multiplying, distributing, getting all the X terms on one side, getting X by itself gives us 4, which means we are going to add 4 liters of the 100% solution to get 20 plus 4, or 24 liters of the 50% solution. Example 2 is the perimeter of a rectangle problem. The length of a rectangle is 3 inches less than twice the width. So, what I found helps on these is go ahead and draw your rectangle, knowing that a rectangle has length and width. It asks us find the length of the rectangle. And normally, if they say find the length, then we're going to let length be X. But in this problem, it says the length is 3 inches less than twice the width. So if we let width be X, then we can set up the length in terms of the width, which would be twice the width minus 3. Now, watch out for this part. 3 inches less than does not mean 3 minus. It means something minus 3. So once you get your rectangle set up, now we go back and say, okay, well, I know that the perimeter of a rectangle is 2L plus 2W. And in this case, we know that the perimeter is 30 because they tell us that. So if we make some substitutions in here, the length is 2x minus 3. The width is just x. So our equation becomes 30 equals 2 times 2x minus 3 plus 2x. Distributing the 2 gives us 4x minus 6 plus 2x. Combining like terms gives us 6x minus 6. Add 6 to both sides gives us 36 equals 6x, which means that x is going to be 6. Now keep in mind, that's not our solution, or that's not the answer, because it says find the length. Well, x, if you'll remember, was the width. The length is 2 times that minus 3, which is 12 minus 3, so the length is 9. Now, does it check? 3 inches less than twice the width, so if the width is 6, twice the width would be 12, 3 less than that would be 9. That part checks. Is the perimeter 30? Well, if this is 9, this is 9, this is 6, this is 6, if you add up all 4 sides, yes, we do get a perimeter of 30. So now let's answer the question. Find the length. Well, we said up here that the length was 9. And we're doing inches, so the length would be 9 inches. Example 3 deals with break-even analysis, which we use in marketing and businesses. The cost C is the amount of money required to produce X items. The revenue R is the amount of money you earn by selling X items. And the profit P is the difference in the revenue and the cost. Now, if you'll think about it, the revenue is the amount of money that you bring in. The cost is the amount of money that you pay out. And profit is how much you bring in minus how much you pay out. Now, the break-even point is the number of items that you must sell in order to have the cost equal to the revenue. So, when they are asking you for break-even, then you're going to set your cost equal to the revenue. Let's do an example. Peripheral Visions Incorporated produces studio-quality audio tapes of live concerts. The company places an ad in a trade newsletter. The cost of the ad is $100. Each tape costs $100 to produce, and the company charges $24 per tape. Now, first part says express the cost as a function of X. Now, you've got two different types of costs. You've got the $100 cost up front, and then you've got the $20 per each tape for a cost. So when you set up your cost function, we've got 20x, which is your variable cost times the number of tapes, plus your fixed costs. So our cost function is 20x plus 100. B part says express the revenue as a function of x. Well, if we're selling each tape for $24, then the revenue is 24 times X, or 24 times the number of tapes that we're selling. And then the last part, for what value of X does the revenue equal the cost? Well, you set revenue equal to cost, which means you set 24X equal to 20X plus 100. Solve that, and we get X is 25. Now, when 25 tapes are sold, the company will break even. If we want to solve this on our calculator, because as numbers get larger, the calculator may help us just a little bit. What you're going to do on your calculator is go to y equals, enter y1 as 20x plus 100, and y2 as 24x. When we graph those, let me go back and start something. Probably you will start out at a zoom 6, which is our standard screen. Notice you can't even tell anything about where they're going to intersect. So if we go down to zoom fit, which is zoom 0, and hit enter, that usually will go out and find us a fairly nice window to use. Here we can see that the lines are going to intersect. We just can't see where. So then what we can do is say zoom out, which is zoom 3. And when we zoom out, we do actually see where they intersect this time. So that's what we're looking for. So we go second calculate. Number 5 is where the lines intersect. Enter for the first curve, enter for the second curve, enter for the guess. And that says that X is 25. So that means that we would have to sell 25 tapes to break even. Now, what does the 600 mean? Well, if you plug 25 into this one, you get 20 times 25, which is 500, plus 1. So to produce 25 tapes, the cost is $600. When you sell 25 tapes here, 24 times 25 is 600, which means the revenue is 600. That is your break-even point. Okay, fourth type, the direct variation problems. We're going to do the Y varies directly. Later we will do the Y varies inversely. But the Y varies directly with X if there is a non-zero number K such that Y equals K times X. Okay, that's what varies directly means. There is a number that is a multiple or that we can multiply by to get Y. Now this K is called the constant of variation. Once you find K for one problem, all problems similar to that will have the same K value. So for instance, if we know that Y varies directly as X, Y came first, so it goes first. Varies directly means we're going to do times K, and it varies directly as X, so we're going to multiply by X. Now we're going to plug in. If Y is 7.5, when X is 3, divide both sides by 3, so we get K is 2.5. Now K will stay 2.5 in this problem. So that is our constant of variation. The equation of variation means Y equals 2.5 times X, because we take that K and plug it back in. This is our equation of variation. Okay, let's try another one. If T varies directly as S, now the T was mentioned first, so it goes first. Varies directly means we're multiplying by K, and it varies directly as S, so we're going to do times S. So we've got T equals 3.96 equals K times 1.2. So we're going to divide both sides by 1.2. So K is equal to, then if we pull up our calculator, we've got 3.96 divided by 1.2. So we've got K is equal to 3.3. Now you notice they didn't ask us for the constant of variation. They didn't ask us for the equation, but we're going to use this K. We're going to plug it back in. T equals 3.3 times S. Now we're going to use this equation in order to find other values. They said find T when S is 5.7. So we're going to plug in 3.3 times 5.7. 3.3 times 5.7. And that would give us T is 18.81. Okay. A different direct variation problem. Hooke's law states that the distance a spring stretches varies directly with the force applied. So, let's find our formula. The distance varies directly with the force. So if we use letters that sort of represent distance and force, that will help us when we start plugging in. Distance equals K times F. D equals K times F. Now, they tell us a force of 15, so we're going to plug in F is 15, when the spring stretches 8 inches, so we're going to plug in D is 8 and F is 15. That gives us a constant of variation of 8 over 15. Then we're going to take that and plug it back in to our formula. And we get D equals 8 over 15 times F. Then the last piece is, with a force of 35, that means we're going to plug in 35 for F. So we'd get 56 over 3, which is 18.6, or about 19 inches. Now the last thing in this module, solving a formula for a specified variable. To solve for a variable means to get that variable on a side by itself. This first formula is solved for I equals. We want to solve for P. If you'll notice that P is being multiplied by RT, then to undo that or to get P by itself, we are going to divide both sides by RT. That way those cancel, so we get P equals I over RT. That's what we're talking about when we say solve for a specific variable. When like this, solve for C. P equals A plus B plus C. Now in this case, you notice we are adding A and B over there with C. So to undo that, we're going to subtract A. We're going to subtract B. So we get P minus A minus B equals C. That's what it means when it says solve for a specified variable. Get C on the side by itself. Now, you're ready to complete this section of homework on my math lab. Make sure you have notes for each of these three sections and make sure you've scored at least a 70 on each homework. After you've done this, then you're ready to take your Module 2 quiz. Remember, you need to be in the math lab or the class to take the quiz. Good luck!